Welcome to another WordPress content crawler video. I will explain the most notable changes made in the version 1.12 of the plugin. You can check out the changelog in the documentation site to see all the changes. Without further ado, let's get started. You will see a warning in the dashboard page when the scheduling is not active. Let me deactivate the scheduling from the general settings page so that we can see the warning. The warning is displayed at the top of the dashboard page. When you activate the scheduling, the warning is not shown. A new setting called Disable SSL Verification is added to the General Settings page. Many users struggle with SSL verification because it requires server configuration to include the root certificates of the certificate authorities. This new setting can be used to bypass the SSL verification. Let me show you what I mean with an example. This website has many subdomains with different kinds of SSL certificates. For example, this one has an expired certificate. This one has an untrusted root certificate. Because these certificates are problematic, the browser does not allow us to immediately see these pages. Normally, the plugin does not allow these as well. Here, I try to retrieve the title from the site that has an untrusted certificate. As you can see, the connection is not established because of the problematic certificate. Now, let me disable the SSL verification. We will use custom general settings because we do not want to bypass the verification for all the sites. We want to do it just for this site. Let's check Disable SSL Verification Settings checkbox and test again. The connection is now established without any issues. Let's go to the tester page and test the site before saving the changes. We see an error here too. Let's save the settings and test again. Please note that disabling SSL verification is not recommended. You should first try to add the root certificates of the certificate authorities to your server. If the issue cannot be resolved that way, you can disable the SSL verification as a last resort. The filters feature now has new properties and commands that can be used to manipulate the HTML code conditionally. Let's go to a site settings page and check them out. When you select the element subject and value property, there are two new commands, which are exchange attributes and remove attributes commands. Also, there are now three additional properties for the element subject. These are attribute value, HTML, and numeric attribute value. Using these, you can change the attribute values of elements, exchange them with each other, and remove them. You can also change the element's HTML code. You can target specific HTML elements by adding condition commands. You can now define the HTTP headers that should be sent to the target site with each request. This page is a custom page I created to explain the HTTP headers. The page displays the headers included in the request that is made to retrieve the contents of the page. Because I opened the page in a browser, it displays all the request headers added to the request by the browser. Let's go to the site settings I configured to crawl this page. When I open the Visual Inspector, the page displays the HTTP request headers sent via the plugin to the target site. Let's close the Visual Inspector and add a header. The header setting is under the main tab. Let me enter a dummy header name and value. Let's refresh the page in the Visual Inspector. As you can see, the dummy header is sent to the target site, even though we haven't yet saved the settings. Let me add another header. Now, let's test the site settings in the tester page before saving the settings. As you can see, our headers are not shown because we did not save the settings. Now, let's save the settings and test again. We can see the headers. Nice. There can be many headers that the target site requires. Entering them one by one is too much work. Let me show you how we can import all the headers at once. We will use the browser's developer tools. Let's open the developer tools by right-clicking and then hitting the inspect option. Let's go to the network tab. This tab displays the requests and their details. We need to refresh the page so that the developer tools can record the requests. Now, let's click to the request at the top. Here, under the headers tab, we can see all the headers. Let's select all the request headers and copy them. Let's go to the headers setting and import these headers. Just click the import button, paste the copied headers, and then hit the import button again. There is a cookie header. The cookies are entered to the cookies setting in the plugin. So let's define the cookies under the cookies setting instead. Done. Let's refresh the visual inspector to make sure the headers are sent as expected. We can see the headers. Cool. Finally, let's test in the tester page as well. Nice. Please note that you do not have to do this for all the sites. Sometimes a site requires a certain HTTP header to exist in the request. Maybe the target site determines the language of the page via a certain request header. You can use the headers setting in such cases. No need to define the headers unless there is a need. You can now set an image from your media library as the featured image. This is done via the set featured image command. Let's see how this command can be used over an example. I will use three different posts to demonstrate the usage of this command. The first post does not have a featured image and it has Google keyword in its title. The second post has a featured image and no keyword in its title we are interested in. The third post does not have a featured image and the keyword we are interested in. I created the settings to crawl these posts' content and featured image. Let me test these three posts via the tester page so that you can see what information is retrieved from them. For this post, we do not have a featured image. This one does not have a featured image as well. This one has the featured image. The title and content exist for all the three posts. Now let's go to the site settings and use the set featured image command. We simply add an action command and select the post subject. Then for the command, we select the set featured image command. We need to enter the ID of the image we want to use as the featured image. If you do not know the ID, you can click the media viewer button. In the media viewer, select the image and click use this image button. Let's save the settings and test the posts again. The image is assigned as the featured image for this one. For this post, a featured image is found in the target page. Let's go to the tools page and crawl this post to see which featured image is used. The featured image is assigned as the one we configured, so the image found in the target page is ignored. Let's say we do not want to assign a custom featured image if there is a featured image in the target post page. To do this, let's add a condition command. This condition will be true if the featured image does not exist in the target post page. Let's copy the CSS selector we used to find the featured image in the target page. Now, this filter is configured such that it will assign the custom featured image only if the featured image is not found in the target page. Let's save the settings and perform a test. As you can see, there is only one featured image, which is the image found in the target page. Let's recrawl the previously crawled post. The expected featured image is assigned. Now, let's see what happens to another post. This post did not have a featured image, so the image we manually assigned is used. With this configuration, we assigned a fallback featured image, meaning that a default featured image will be used if there is no featured image in the target post page. We can add other conditions to our filter. For example, we can check if the post title contains a certain word, and if it does, we can assign a related image. Since one of the posts has Google keyword in it, let me target that keyword. I will add a condition command that checks if the title contains Google in it. Now, I want to use an image that shows Google's logo instead. Let's save the settings and test. The featured image is assigned, since this post meets the conditions. Let's say we do not want to use the same featured image for all the posts. We can define multiple featured images. The plugin will select one of these images randomly. Let's test again. Okay, cool. But what happens to the other post that does not have a feature image? Oops, a featured image is not assigned to this one. Let's fix this. Let's clone our filter. I will remove the keyword condition from the filter at the top. Let me also assign a featured image that is suitable for any post that does not have a featured image. Let's choose this one just as an example. Let's save the settings and test. This post now has the generic featured image. This one still has one of the images that targets the Google keyword. With this setup, we first assign a generic featured image. Then the second filter overwrites the assigned featured image if its condition is met. By this way, we always have a generic featured image for the posts that do not have a featured image. Also, we have a more specific featured image for the posts that meet certain conditions. Before wrapping up, let me show you another setting. Let's go to the general settings page. Under the post tab, there is a setting called protected attachments. This setting is automatically updated when you define an image for the set featured image command. You can also manually add or remove images from this setting. Normally, the plugin deletes the images of a post while recrawling or deleting it. The images added to this setting will not be deleted during these operations. As I said, you do not need to worry about this setting since it is automatically updated when necessary. The filters now have a stop command. There is a stop and delete command. That command still exists. This stop command is the same except for that it does not delete the post. It simply stops the crawling or recrawling operation. Let me demonstrate when this command can be used. Sometimes the target site displays a not found page but does not return a 404 response. In that case, the plugin cannot know that the target page is not a post. If this happens when recrawling, the existing post might be replaced with the contents of the not found page. This command can be used to prevent this from happening. Here, I configured the settings to crawl Twitter's blog site. This is the post we will be using for this example. I modified the page by using the find replace options and added an HTML element that shows 404 not found. Let's assume that the target site displays this element when the page is not found. We can see the element I added in the visual inspector. Now let's use the stop command. I want to stop the recrawling operation if this element exists in the target page. So I first add a condition command that will be true only when a post is being recrawled. Next, I add a command that will be true when the element that says 404 not found exists in the page. Let's add the stop command among the action commands of the filter. It is recommended that you write a brief reason so that you won't be surprised when this command is executed. Now let's save and test our settings. The command is not executed. This is because we are currently crawling, not recrawling. The command is configured to execute only when recrawling. Let's save this post via the manual crawling tool. The post is saved correctly. Now let's manually recrawl it. The stop command is executed. The recrawling operation is stopped. Here we can see the reason we typed earlier. Now let me remove the HTML element that indicates the post is not found. Let's recrawl. The post is recrawled without any issues since the condition of the filter is not met because the 404 not found element does not exist in the page. Let me add the element again and recrawl again. The operation is stopped as expected. When the plugin crawls the posts, it first creates a post with title, content, and other basic information. When this happens, the Save Post hook of WordPress is triggered. After that, the plugin saves additional information such as post meta and taxonomy values. The Save Post hook is not triggered after this operation. However, your theme or plugins might be listening to the Save Post hook to carry out certain operations. For example, they might be checking if a certain post meta or taxonomy value exists for the post. Because the plugin does not trigger the Save Post hook after the additional information is added to the post, these third-party software cannot work properly. When the trigger save post hook setting is enabled, the plugin will trigger the save post hook after the post and all its details are completely saved. By this way, if the other third-party software installed on your site listens to this hook, they will be notified so that they can do their thing. The trigger save post hook setting is available under the post tab in the other section, which is at the bottom of the page. If you find yourself going to the edit page of the crawled posts and clicking to the update button to make certain things work, enabling the trigger save post hook setting might do the job for you. I hope you like these new features. If you have suggestions or new feature ideas, let us know in the comments section below. Thanks for watching. See you in another WordPress content crawler video.